Dear students, in this class, we will discuss about non-rigid rotator model and the rotational spectra of polyatomic molecules. While solving the Schrödinger wave equation for a rotating diatomic molecule and deriving the energy, we had assumed that a rotating molecule is a rigid rotator, that is, the bond length is fixed or the bond is a rigid one. But in reality, the bonds in a diatomic molecule is not a rigid one. And in fact, all bonds are elastic to some extent. So let's see what are the consequences of this elasticity. An elastic bond may have vibrational energy. That is, the bond will stretch and compress periodically with a certain fundamental frequency, which depends upon the masses of the atoms and the elasticity or force constant of the bond. The second consequence is that the quantities R and B vary during vibration. R is the bond length and B is the rotational constant. Now comes an important term, which is the centrifugal distortion. We know that when a molecule rotates, there will be a centrifugal force which tends to move the atoms apart. When the bond is a rigid one, we had neglected the distortion due to centrifugal force. But now the bones are not much rigid, they are elastic to some extent. So when such a diatomic molecule rotates, the more faster a diatomic molecule rotates, the greater will be the centrifugal force tending to move the atoms apart. So while considering the energy of such a non-rigid rotator, we will have to include this centrifugal distortion also. So the Schrödinger equation may be set up, and the energy for such a non-rigid rotator is given as epsilon j equals bj into j plus 1 minus dj square into j plus 1 the whole square in centimeter inverse, where B is the usual rotational constant and D is a term called centrifugal distortion constant. And its value is given by D equals h cube by 32 pi raised to 4 I square R square K C centimeter inverse. Now this is a small positive quantity. For a diatomic molecule, the centrifugal distortion constant D is related to the rotational constant B and also the fundamental vibrational frequency nu by the relation D equals 4B cube by nu bar square centimeter inverse, where nu bar is the frequency in centimeter inverse or in wave number. Nu bar equals nu by C, okay, which is equal to 1 by 2 pi C root of K by mu. So this is the equation for the energy of a non-rigid rotator, bj into j plus 1 minus dj square into j plus 1 the whole square. Now if you look at the equation for d, that is d equals h cube by 32 pi raised to 4 I square r square kc, we can see that d is inversely proportional to the moment of inertia I, the bond length r, and also the force constant k. So it's clear that the centrifugal distortion effects are greatest for molecules with small moments of inertia and small force constant. So in a given molecule, the effect of centrifugal distortion is to decrease the rotational energy, which increases rapidly for higher rotational states. As we can see in this diagram, the left side represents the energy levels of a rigid rotator and the right side represents the energy levels of a non-rigid rotator. And we can see the lowering of the rotational levels when passing from the rigid to the non-rigid diatomic molecule. And this lowering of the energy levels is due to the centrifugal distortion term. The selection rule for a non-rigid diatomic molecule will be the same as that for a rigid one, that is delta J equals plus or minus 1. The spectra will also be somewhat similar, with only difference is that there will be a relative lowering of the energy levels. The frequency of transition from J to J plus 1. In a non-rigid rotator is given by epsilon J plus 1 minus epsilon J equals 2B into J plus 1 minus 4D into J plus 1 the whole cube centimeter inverse. So in this equation, the first term is the same as that due to a rigid molecule. That's for a rigid rotator, 2B into J plus 1. The second term, that is 4D into J plus 1 the whole cube, gives the shift of the lines from that of a rigid molecule, and this shift increases with increasing J as J plus 1 the whole cube. Now let's see what all information we get from the distortion constant D. It allows us to determine the J value of lines in an observed spectrum using the equation 2B J plus 1 minus 4D into J plus 1 the whole cube. Okay. If you have measured a few transitions, it's not always easy to determine from which J value they arise. Okay, but if you look at this equation, we will obtain the values for, we'll get unique values for B, D and J. The second one is that a knowledge of D enables us to determine the vibrational frequency of a diatomic molecule. We have seen this equation, that is D equals 4B cube by nu bar square. So from this, we will get the vibrational frequency of the diatomic molecule. So we have discussed the non-rigid rotator model. In the equation for energy, there will be an additional term including the centrifugal distortion, and the frequency of transition is given by 2b into j plus 1 minus 4d into j plus 1 the whole cube. The selection rule is the same as that for a rigid diatomic molecule, that is delta J equals plus or minus 1. The spectrum will also be similar, with only difference is that there will be a relative lowering of the energy levels when compared to the rigid rotator. Next, we will discuss about the rotational spectra of polyatomic molecules, including linear molecules and symmetric top molecules in detail. So first we will have just an overview of linear molecules. Linear molecules are those molecules in which the atoms are arranged in a straight line. For example, HCl, OCS, carbon oxysulfide, carbon dioxide, etc. We usually take three directions of rotations, or three moment of inertia designated as IA, IB and IC. So IA is about the bond axis, the molecular symmetry axis, and for linear molecules, the moment of inertia about this bond axis is zero, that is IA is equal to zero. The second one is the end over end rotation in the plane of the paper, and the third is the end over end rotation at right angles or perpendicular to the plane. And these two rotations are equivalent, or IB equals IC. Now about the rotational spectrum of a linear molecule. So this gives rise to a simple spectrum similar to the diatomic molecules. The energy levels are given by epsilon J equals BJ into J plus 1 minus DJ square into J plus 1 the whole square centimeter inverse. Here we have included the centrifugal distortion term. The selection rule is again the same, delta J equals plus or minus 1. The separation between the lines is also 2B, definitely modified by the distortion constant. So the selection rules, the energy level expression, the separation between the lines, all are similar to that of a diatomic molecule. Okay. But we have to remember a few points while dealing with the rotational spectrum of a linear polyatomic molecule. The moment of inertia for the end over end rotation of a polyatomic linear molecule is considerably greater than that of a diatomic molecule. And hence, the rotational constant B will be much smaller and the spectral lines will be more closely spaced. For example, the B values for a diatomic molecule are about 10 cm inverse. While for triatomic molecules, it can be 1 cm inverse or less. And for larger molecules, it will be still smaller. In the case of linear polyatomic molecules, the essential condition for a molecule to exhibit a rotational spectrum is still the same. That is, the molecule must possess a dipole moment if it is to exhibit a rotational spectrum. Thus, OCS molecule, that is carbon oxysulfide, will be microwave active, while carbon dioxide CO2, it will not be microwave active. Isotopic substitution does not lead to a dipole moment because the bond length or the atomic charges are unaltered or they are not changed by isotopic substitution. So CO2 is microwave inactive. If we replace one of the oxygen by its isotope, that is O16CO18, that will still be microwave inactive. In general, a non-cyclic polyatomic molecule containing n atoms will have n-1 individual bond lengths to be determined. If we take the example of carbon oxysulfide, that is OCS, we have to determine the CO distance, that is RCO, and also there is a CS distance, RCS. So two bond lengths are to be determined, but there is only one moment of inertia and only this one value can be determined from the spectra. Now let's see how to derive the moment of inertia of a linear triatomic molecule like OCS, carbon oxysulfide. So this is the molecule of OCS showing the distances of each atom from the center of gravity. We have three distances, that is RO, RC and RS. Consideration of moments gives MORO plus MCRC equals MSRS. And let this be equation 1. So the moment of inertia, the total moment of inertia I equals MORO square plus MCRC square plus MSRS square. Equation 2. We have the distance RO equals RCO plus RC. Similarly, RS equals RCS minus RC. Equation 3. RCO and RCS are the bond lengths of the molecule. Substituting equation 3 in 1 and collecting the terms, we get MORCO plus MORC plus MCRC equals MSRCS minus MSRC. So in equation 1, instead of RO, we have written RCO plus RC, and instead of RS, we have written RCS minus RC. Okay, so that is collecting the like terms, MC plus MO plus MS into RC equals MSRCS minus MORCO, or we can write MRC equals MSRCS minus MORCO, where M is the total mass of the molecule. Now substituting equation 3 in equation 2, we get I equals MO into, instead of RO, write RCO plus RC, the whole square, plus MCRC square plus MS into, instead of RS, write RCS minus RC, the whole square, which is equal to capital MRC square plus 2RC into MORCO minus MSRCS plus MORCO square plus MSRCS square. From equation 4, we get RC equals MSRCS minus MORCO by M. Therefore, the moment of inertia I equals M into, here we have RC square. So instead of RC square, write this RC equals MSRCS minus MORCO by M. So capital M into MSRCS minus MORCO by M the whole square plus 2 into Again, here we have RC. So instead of RC, right, MS RCS minus MO RCO by M into MO RCO minus MS RCS plus MO RCO square plus MS RCS square. That is, the moment of inertia I equals MO RCO square plus MS RCS square minus MO RCO minus MS RCS the whole square by M. So this is how we determine the moment of inertia of a triatomic molecule like OCS. So though there are two bond lengths to be determined, there is only one value of moment of inertia which is given by this equation. Next, we are going to discuss the rotational spectra of symmetric top molecules. In the case of linear molecules, two moment of inertia were equal and the third one was equal to zero. But in the case of symmetric top molecules, two of the principal moments of inertia are equal, but the third one is not zero. And also IB equals IC, but it's not equal to IA. Symmetric top is classified into two types, prolate symmetric top and oblate symmetric top. In prolate symmetric top, for example, molecules like CH3Cl, CH3F, CH3CN, NH3, etc. IB equals IC, but it is greater than the third moment of inertia, greater than IA. Whereas in the case of oblate symmetric top, that is in the case of molecules like BCl3, BF3, etc., IB equals IC, but it is less than IA. So when we discuss the rotational spectra of symmetric top molecules, we need two quantum numbers to describe the degree of rotation, one for IA and the other for IB or IC. We are directly going to the equation of energy. So for a rigid prolate symmetric top, the energy is given by EJK equals h square by 8 pi square IB J into J plus 1 plus h square by 8 pi square IA minus h square by 8 pi square IB into K square in joules. In terms of wave number, we can write epsilon J equals BJ into J plus 1 plus A minus B into K square centimeter inverse. Here J and K represents the two rotational quantum numbers. In the case of an oblate symmetric top, the energy equation becomes epsilon J equals BJ into J plus 1 plus C minus B into K square. A, B and C are the rotational constants. The value of A is h by 8 pi square IA into C, B equals h by 8 pi square IB into C, and C equals h by 8 pi square IC into C. Here J and K are the rotational quantum numbers. The quantum number J represents the total angular momentum of the molecule, and K represents the angular momentum component about the molecular symmetry axis. Now let's see what all values can J and K have. J can have 0 or integer values like 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. And K can have values 0, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, etc. up to plus or minus J. In general, for a total angular momentum J, K can take values J, J minus 1, J minus 2, etc. up to 0, etc. minus J minus 1, minus J. That is, for a given value of J, K can have a total of 2 J plus 1 values. And all levels with K greater than 0 are doubly degenerate because of the occurrence of the K square term. In the equation for energy, we have BJ into J plus 1 plus A minus B into K square, right? So the energy depends on K square. So it is immaterial whether the symmetric top molecule spins clockwise or anticlockwise. Whether it spins clockwise or anticlockwise, the energy will be the same for a given angular momentum. So for all levels with k greater than 0, those rotational levels will be doubly degenerate. Now the selection rule is delta j equals plus or minus 1 and also delta k equals 0. In the case of a linear molecule, the selection rule was delta j equals plus or minus 1 alone. Now we have a second quantum number k, so we have to add that also. So the selection rule for a symmetric top molecule becomes delta j equals plus or minus 1 and delta k equals 0. The frequency of the transitions is given by epsilon j plus 1 k minus epsilon j k equals 2b into j plus 1 centimeter inverse. Since delta k equals 0, that term will not come in this equation. So the frequency of transition is same as that for a linear molecule. So that is equal to 2b into j plus 1 centimeter inverse. So since k is not appearing in this equation, the rotational spectrum of a symmetric top molecule is independent of k. And hence, rotational changes about the symmetry axis do not give rise to a rotational spectrum. Why delta k equals 0? We know that the dipole moment of the symmetric top is directed along the symmetry axis. So, a rotation of the molecule about this symmetry axis will not cause any change in the dipole moment. And we know that the essential condition for a molecule to show rotational spectrum is that the rotations must cause a change in the dipole moment, right? So here, there is no change in the dipole moment when the molecule is rotated along the symmetry axis. And hence, the rotation cannot interact with the electromagnetic radiation. That's why delta K is equal to 0. So as a consequence, the spectrum will be independent of the quantum number k, and the rotational spectrum of a symmetric top molecule will be just the same as that for a linear molecule. And we can measure only one moment of inertia, that is for nth over nth rotation can be measured. Now next two categories of molecules are the spherical tops and asymmetric top molecules. The spherical top molecules are microwave inactive, so there is no point in discussing their spectra. So the last category is the asymmetric top molecules, and most of the molecules belong to this category. Asymmetric top molecules have all three moments of inertia different, that is IA not equal to IB not equal to IC. And the spectra of such asymmetric rotors is very complex. Plus or minus k degeneracy, which exists for the symmetric top molecules, is generally broken in the case of asymmetric top molecules. The spectrum, rotational spectrum, will be very complex, and it's difficult to derive the equation for energy levels in the case of asymmetric top molecules.